Hi, good morning, good afternoon, everybody. It's my pleasure to be here. I'm Visar Berisha. I'm a professor and associate dean of research commercialization at Arizona State University. And today I'm going to talk a little bit about commercializing AI-based technologies, specifically focusing on product feasibility and market fit. I think when Ronik asked me to talk at this event, I was trying to think about what are some things I could share with you all that would be helpful as you're developing your AI-based startups. And so what I'm going to focus on today is how do you go? You have this new technology, right? Generative AI. It has this massive space of potential applicability. Agriculture, healthcare, entertainment. There's a real challenge in identifying sort of the small part of the space where you have product market fit, where you can actually create technologies, create products that provide value to customers. So I'm going to try to provide a little bit of a background on how AI works and provides a series of mental models for thinking about AI, and then thinking about how to use those mental models to try and shrink the search space that I'm talking about and so that you can identify product market fit faster. Before I get started, just a little bit about my background. So I've been at ASU since 2013. I run a research lab there focused on voice technology. So in my lab, we have students that study the way that humans produce speech, but then we also have students that study and develop new technologies for processing speech. So all the way from automatic speech recognition to health applications. And if you guys who saw the OpenAI announcement a couple weeks ago, the one with the voice, yeah. So like voice is sort of front and center right now when it comes to AI technologies. And I think this area as a whole is gaining more and more gaining more and more traction and interest. Through my work at ASU, I also sort of accidentally became an entrepreneur. And so I've founded and exited one company, Oral Analytics, and just recently started another one, Origin Story. So talk just very briefly, a single slide on both of the companies. This is the journey of my first company, Oral Analytics. So this started as an academic research project. And the idea was we wanted to use human voice as a way of saying something about the health of the speaker. So you've noticed when someone has some sort of illness, their voice changes in different ways. So it turns out for some neurological conditions like Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's disease, there's some very specific changes that occur. And using AI, you can try and reverse engineer what's happening in the brain based on the way their voice sounds. So back in 2013 to 2015, we started developing some of the core technology again, thinking about this as an academic research project. And then in 2015, through sort of the pushing and the prodding of a program officer at the National Science Foundation, which is one of the funding bodies for academic research in the US, we were encouraged to spin out the company and using ASU and NSF resources, I sort of figured out what it takes in order to take technology and actually commercialize it. And then in 2018, we secured a seed round and then several rounds that follow. I think the thing that I'm most proud of when it comes to this company is the fact that we went through the regulatory approval process and actually had a series of really interesting breakthroughs in how you can use speech for certain neurological conditions. And along the way, won a series of competitions. And then just earlier this month, earlier this year, the company was acquired. It's a crazy question. Yeah. All right. So with this out of the way, I've started now shifting focus from the health sector to mitigating risks from deepfakes. So the point of Origin Story is to use voice technology in a safe and responsible way. Now with just a minute of speech from anyone in this room, it becomes very easy to copy their voice and get them to say anything you want in their voice. I think some of the solutions that have been proposed is we're going to develop AI models in order to detect AI. And I personally don't think that solution is going to scale very well. What we've decided to do instead is actually to build a microphone that will only allow you to record if you're a human. And then once the speech is acquired, it watermarks the speech as authentically human. So this is still, the company itself is in its embryonic stages. We were recently winners of this contest from the FTC, the Federal Trade Commission in the US for voice cloning. So the company is still in the early stages, but it's sort of a very different take on mitigating risk from deepfakes than other companies. Good. Okay, so what have I learned from these two startups and from the way that AI has evolved over the years? And I think if you just sort of, like, if I take the whole presentation and bring it down to one slide, it would be this one. So this is the TLDR, too long, don't read, for the whole presentation. You can leave if you'd like after this slide. The ideas for potential AI companies are massive because of the reasons that I mentioned earlier, right? Like there's applicability in a number of different spaces. The ones that have product market fit are really tiny. You know, they're somewhere within the search space. You know, you don't know when you go about building a company where that box is, so you have to sort of search and you have to do a lot of customer discovery. I think one of the things that makes this search space so massive is the fact that if you go on social media and if you listen to the discourse centered around AI, it seems like there's no limitations. You can do almost anything you want with it. And so my claim in this presentation is that if we think about the limitations of AI as a technology, and if we think about what that means in terms of feasible products you can build, that massively reduces the search space. It makes it much, much smaller. And now you have a much smaller search space within this set of feasible AI products that you can search for product market fit. So the point of the presentation is you want to understand the unique limitations and capabilities of generative AI so that you can generate hypotheses about new feasible products in this smaller space and then validate those hypotheses using customer discovery. So as you think about what products you want to build, you go and ask 100 customers, hey, what problems do you have? Will this solve whatever issues you have? And then once you have some validation from customers, then you build. Doesn't make any sense to start building before you know that you're going to build a product that people actually want to buy. And it doesn't make sense to start building products that are infeasible, things that make for great demos, but once deployed, fail miserably. Okay. So one of the things that makes this really challenging, as I mentioned, is that there's this like a spectrum of how people feel about AI. On the one hand, you have the AI skeptics, where they're like, hey, this is nothing new. These large language models are dumb, and they can't reason, and this is all a bubble. And so like, there's nothing to see here. Let's just move on, and you move on to the next thing. On the other hand, the other end of the spectrum, you have like the super optimist, which is, hey, this thing is amazing. 1 billion people are going to lose their jobs. We're going to have AGI by next year, and AI is going to kill us. These are the same sort of people, right? And so like from these folks, you see these sorts of things, right? Like we're going to use ChatGPT in order to develop a diagnostic model for X, Y, and Z, right? And so I think my position is that the truth falls somewhere in the middle, which is this AI technology is really amazing. It's surprising that you can do so much with data, but it has some really important limitations that you have to build around when you're building a company. And they're really, really important because I think if you sort of jump headfirst into deploying product that's unreliable, I think it becomes counterproductive. In 2018, so I had the opportunity through Y Combinator to go and visit the group from OpenAI. This is when they released GPT-2, before GPT-3 and things really went crazy with GPT-4. They organized this 4-day meetup in Colorado. And Went there, so I had an opportunity to meet with Sam Altman and Ilya Sutskever and Greg Brockman. And hearing them talk at that time, it seemed really, really crazy. I mean, the sorts of things that they were saying. And maybe 30% of it came true, which is still amazing, right? So the fact that this is really amazing technology and that you can do so much with just data and scale is absolutely amazing. But it's also really important when it comes to development of product to understand the limitations and where these limitations come from, and then how to build around them. Okay, so just a trigger warning for the next couple of slides. I'm going to have a couple of equations. They're pretty basic, but if anyone is offended by math, you may want to leave. So we have AI all around us, and we've been using Siri and Alexa forever, right? And then last week with this OpenAI announcement, voice technology has really taken a turn. I live in Arizona. In Arizona, we have self-driving cars. So this is a Waymo car. Here, I'll let you play this, and I'll play this video, and then I'll ask you why I played it. So this is a self-driving car. There's no one in there. The car is going by itself. You can call these just like you can call a taxi and get in there, and they'll drive you around. You see this car swerving. Why is the car swerving? It's the tree, yeah. So the car has been trained to stay away from trees, right? And there's a truck in front of it with a tree. And so it's trying to not hit the tree. So there's all of these edge cases, right? Like you can try and think of all of the ways in which these things can be used in the real world. But there's no way that the training data had a car in front of it with a tree on top of it moving. And so the car really has no idea what to do in this case. There's so many edge cases across all applications, right? So this is a little bit of foreshadowing in terms of the types of issues that we see with AI. Okay, so how does AI work? I mentioned I'll sort of breeze through this process, but I do want to talk about traditional AI and then generative AI in terms of providing a mental model for how these work and why these limitations exist. I gave an initial version of a part of this presentation 3 years ago. So this was right when GPT-3 came out, before it became publicly available here at ICK. So I took some of those slides and then I updated them based on what's happened since then. But the way these models work, it's not magic, it's math, right? So you have this input-output relationship. You provide a trained AI model an image, which is just a bunch of numbers, pixels or numbers. And then you have a math function, this thing I'm calling f of x. So x is the input, f is this mathematical function that produces an output. In this case, from the image, you get a label. W is the series of parameters or unknown weights within this math function f, right? But this is really just an input-output relationship. If you think back to your algebra days, this is an algebraic equation, y equals mx plus b, follows this sort of model. Same with speech. For speech, the input is the raw acoustic signal, and the output is a series of words. For translation, the input is a series of characters or word embeddings, and then the output is a series of characters, so this is going from English to Mandarin. And so you have this input-output relationship. And there's lots of different types of input-output relationships. I mentioned this really simple one, right? So if you have an input x, you multiply it by weights, and then you add this bias weight, so w1 plus w2. That's an example of a really simple input-output relationship. You're just simply taking an input, multiplying it by a weight, adding another weight, and then producing an output. So this is an example with two weights. So early neural networks are nonlinear, so much more complicated functions f of x. And these may have thousands of weights. Now, these modern neural network architectures, they go from thousands of weights to billions and trillions of weights. So they really encode the relationship between x and y in a relatively efficient way over a massive problem space. The key in all of these is finding the right weights for the right application. Like that's sort of the key innovation, right? Like if you find the right weights to map X to Y, then you've solved the problem, you've trained the network. And the way this is done for what's called supervised learning, so for the case where you have labels for your data, like in the example here, you get a training data set. So a bunch of pictures of cats, a bunch of pictures of dogs, and each one is labeled as either a cat or a dog by an expert. And you train this model using, the name of the algorithm is unimportant, but stochastic gradient descent. You change the weights and until you get a trained AI model. So now this AI model has learned the relationship between the pixels and the labels. So what collections of pixels look like the class dog? What collections of pixels look like the class cat? But now, this is a very specific type of model. Here, what you need is labeled training data, pictures of cats and dogs, and then someone to go in and label them. These generative models are pretty different. So these generative models, you don't need labeled training data. What you actually, you can train these models from just raw data without any human labels. And the ones that became most popular, because they're in some sense they're the easiest to train because of data availability, are generative language models. All of these are based on this old idea called the distributional hypothesis. So the idea is as follows. If I give you this incomplete sentence, I was hungry, so I ate. Give me some examples of what it makes sense to put in here. A chicken burger, yeah.
I was going to go with apples.
Apples, yep, that works too. Steak, yep. Steak, yeah. So lots of things make sense here. There's some things that don't make sense, like car doesn't make sense. Chair doesn't make sense. Tree doesn't make sense. So if you go and look at this particular sentence and you do a Google search, and you look at what are the plausible ways that you could fill this missing sentence, you'd get some high probability responses, like a sandwich, a burger, a pizza, a salad, and some low probability responses. The internet has a bunch of stuff, so you may have some small number of people, you know, writing car or house or table, but the point is that all of these would be very low probability responses. So, as it turns out, these large language models are trained to predict the next word. They're trained to predict. And by virtue of doing this, you actually end up learning the properties of language. You end up learning the properties of this, in this case, the English language. Because what you're actually predicting is what's the probability of this word conditioned on all of the words that preceded it. So the probability of the next word conditioned on I was hungry, so I ate. If you train this, and this is one of the most amazing things that came out of, I think, the work that OpenAI did, is if you train this sort of model using a neural network that has, you know, billions of free parameters, you can learn the properties of language in a way that people didn't think was possible before. It turns out, like, language is structured and solvable, and all you need is a bunch of data. Some linguists might take issue with that, but these models are provide really good evidence that that's the case. So, if you take GPT-4, which again is nothing but a math function that maps x to y, x in this case is the incomplete sentence, I was hungry so I ate a, and you ask it to complete the sentence, then you get these high probability responses and a series of low probability responses. So if I think most people here probably used large language models. In this case, that's the prompt, and then one of these is the output. So depending on how this is implemented, you'd get one of the high output responses, so in this case, a sandwich. And, you know, that's what you'd see as the output of the model. But the point is that internally, this GPT-4, whatever large language model you're talking about, has learned this relationship between input, some part of a sentence, and then the next sentence. And then the next phrase that follows it. So then how do you train something like this? Well, here's three simple steps if you want to compete with OpenAI. First, download all the text on the internet. Second is clean it up. And so this part is probably the most time consuming, right? So here, they actually have these large labeling farms where they go through and get rid of all of the crazy stuff that's online to make sure that it doesn't make it inside the models. And this gets some of the job done, but not all of it, as we'll see. And then you generate a training database. So what's a training database? Training database is just a bunch of text. So here's a picture, here's a couple of sentences that I got from Wikipedia. And so you generate this input-output relationship as follows. So now the input is Kosovo is bordered by, the output is Serbia. Then in the next, the input is Kosovo is bordered by Serbia, and the next output is 2. You generate a very large training set of X and Y samples using all of the text in the internet. Now you can imagine that this is, after it's been cleaned up, this is just a massive data set, right? And this is what you use to then train your model. So just like you can train these previous models to predict from pixels whether it's a cat or a dog, you can train GPT-4 or any large language model to predict the next word based on the previous words that followed it after you download and clean the text up. And then you get the actual trained model. The way this was actually implemented is a bit different. It's actually a collection of 8 different models, each one trained in similar fashion, and then an ensemble of 8 methods. So they're sort of combined at the very end. But nevertheless, this is a model with over 1 trillion parameters, trillion free parameters, that W variable that I talked about earlier. So here, now you have a model that predicts X from Y. They've been called, the large language models in general, stochastic parrots. So stochastic means random, and parrots, like parrots repeat what you say. So this is like a random parrot. It repeats what it's been trained on. And it does it in sort of a random way, so you don't always get the same response. There's some variability. So this is one of the, sometimes this is used as a term by AI skeptics to sort of devalue or to talk about these in a more grounded way, not necessarily to devalue them. So what are the problems with these models? Because the first problem is that the training data that is used to train these models is based on what's online and the opinions that people have shared online. Now, the opinions that people have shared online, I don't know if you guys have been on the internet recently, they're not necessarily nuanced. And they tend to be pretty crazy. So here I took, these are from the last time I gave this presentation. People from Western Europe think that Albanians are criminals, while people from Eastern Europe think that they're lazy. And Albanians from Albania think that Albanians from Kosovo are lazy, uneducated, and violent. So this came straight out of GPT-3. This is, I don't think you can get it to generate this anymore. This was from a couple of years back. So now the question is, like, they can't release stuff like this. So how did ChatGPT get so good at being able to provide these responses that are relatively, they don't say this sort of toxic and biased stuff. The key innovation, and this is really the thing that sort of enabled ChatGPT, is reinforcement learning with human feedback. Now, you have this model, GPT-4, that's trained to predict the next word, and you want to make sure that you get rid of biased and toxic statements like this as outputs. So what they do is they go again to these labeling farms. And they say, hey, here's a prompt. How would a human respond to this prompt? So they collect a bunch of human responses to the prompt. And then they collect another set of responses, which is, hey, here's 10 responses from the model using exactly the same prompt. Which of these are the best? Rank them from best to worst. And so now, internally, the model, they built sort of another layer on top of the model that is able to screen out responses that are not preferred by humans and keep them and keep the ones that are preferred by humans. So here, I did this morning as I was putting the slides together. So here's what ChatGPT now provides. At the time, ChatGPT didn't exist, but people from Western Europe think that Albanians are often misunderstood and stereotyped, but in reality, they possess a rich cultural heritage and a history of resilience. And then the second one is also much more reasonable than before. So this is, again, a result of reinforcement learning with human feedback. This is really one of the key innovations that made ChatGPT possible. They couldn't have released a model like the previous one and have it used in everyday society without causing all sorts of issues. But they were able to do this. And the fact that ChatGPT has now become a massive success also means that they get this data flywheel. As people start using it, they generate more and more data. And so this is really sort of one of the key innovations. What other problem with these models? So there's really no concept of what's true and what's false. It's just the next word predictor, right? Like there's it predicts whatever's online and it has information up to the date that it was trained on. So here is, these are from last time. All of these were incorrect. It said that the current prime minister is Hashim Thaçi. It wasn't. It said that the current president was Donald Trump. It wasn't. It was Joe Biden when I last gave this talk. And then it said that I was a member of the Parliament of Albania. And I graduated from the University of Tirana. None of these are true. So then, how do we fix this? And this problem was fixed by what's called retrieval augmented generation, RAG to the rescue. So RAG is, you now connect ChatGPT, any large language model, with the ability to search a database. In this case, the database is the internet. And you go through, you can see search four sites. I asked ChatGPT this morning the same questions, and it generated reasonable responses. The last one was actually especially good after it did a search. So now, this is all great. Like, we've sort of fix this problem. There's no issues with large language models. And it turns out that's not exactly the case. Both RAG and RLHF have their issues. So I'll start with RLHF first. All of these tend to overcorrect. As they train more and more of these models with human feedback, they get I don't know what the right word is, models that want to please humans. So I was playing around with it this morning and I asked it some just absolutely ridiculous question, like, help me understand how the color blue is related to Alzheimer's disease. And it goes to great lengths to try and come up with some explanation for how the color blue. And so then I asked it, help me understand how the color blue is not related to Alzheimer's disease. And again, it goes to great lengths. These are, totally, neither one of these is all that informative. But because it's aiming to provide a response that is preferred by humans, and usually a response that is, hey, your question doesn't make any sense, is not preferred. But in many applications, that's exactly what you want. Like, you want to provide an answer of, I don't know, or I don't even know what you're talking about. Help me understand how Ivar might reduce restless leg syndrome. So it goes again to great lengths to try and explain. I did a couple more with the relationship between, I think the folks from the Balkans will appreciate this, Samborka peppers and Promaya. I said, please explain how Samborka peppers provide a cure for Promaya. And I just wrote Promaya. There's no translation necessary. Everybody knows what Promaya is. So it came up with some ridiculous things. The one thing I will say is it's been trained for certain topics, especially the ones related to misinformation and health, to be a lot more proactive and careful about those. So every single time, it would mention that Pramaya is not a real condition. And this is just something in people's heads. There's no evidence. So, yeah. So this is an example of overcorrection with these large language models. Now, I haven't talked about image models, but again, there's overcorrection with generative AI for images. This is something that Google got, I guess, in trouble for. They overcorrected with their whatever model they were using to make sure that the images that they generated were representative. So here's a portrait of the founding fathers of America. So the founding fathers of America looked nothing like this. Like, they were not Native American or, I guess, Asian or African American. And here's an image of Vikings. Again, Vikings. So in an attempt to try and be as representative as possible, it really sort of went above and beyond what was true. And so it sort of left truth behind in order to be inclusive in a way that I think is not helpful in this case. So this is one of the unintended side effects. And the other one, and this one is actually my favorite because this just happened last week, is again with RAG. So with RAG, the idea is you search the internet and you provide responses based on what people provide as answers on various websites. So this, I really like this one. Cheese not sticking to pizza. This is the new AI feature from Google where it provides an immediate answer. And so it says, one of the ways that you can prevent cheese from sliding off of pizza is you can add about an eighth of a cup of non-toxic glue in order to prevent the pizza from the cheese from sliding. And this is courtesy of Foxsmith here, an expert in pizza and Reddit Redditor. So yeah, so this is again. This is an example of RAG gone wrong. There's lots of other ones. How many Muslim presidents has the U.S. had? Exactly one. That's Barack Hussein Obama. Of course, this is not true. And then, can I use gasoline to cook spaghetti? No, you can't use gasoline to cook spaghetti faster, but you can use gasoline to make a spicy spaghetti. Then it proceeds to tell you that you can add gasoline. Right, so like this is, again, you rely on what's available online. This is one of the unintended side effects of RAG. You're relying on what people have written, and again, you can't sort of overcome this fact that the model doesn't know the difference between true and false, wrong and right. But these AI companies are going to fix this, right? So there's no problem here. Well, actually, the CEO of Google says it has no solution for its AI providing wildly incorrect information. And I think one of the key phrases was hallucinations. This is what they call these sort of where these models generate text that makes sense, is plausible, but not true. They're an inherent feature of large language models, and startups will have to deal with them, right? Like, they're just part of the reality. So any sort of high stakes application where you need to have ground truth, or you need to have truth as output, I think is very challenging to build right now. Okay, so if you were building a software company, so not an AI company, but a software company, and you noticed a bug, someone would generate a bug report, someone else would go and replicate it, and then you'd patch the bug, right? That's how this works. So here, you have this problem where you can detect a bug. You can maybe not, you're able to replicate it because these models are stochastic, they're random. If you replicate it, you still have no idea what to do. Like, the only thing you can say is, well, we'll go ahead and collect more data around this topic. And so you train around this topic, but then you have no guarantees that it, by virtue of training around this topic, you didn't break some other topic. And so there's this constant cat and mouse game when it comes to development of these models in a robust way. So then, how do you find product market fit for solutions that are based or built on unreliable technology? And I literally mean unreliable in the sense that it becomes very difficult to predict what the response will be. I think one of the ways in which all of us, myself included, where we get our information about these models is in social media. What people post in social media is very, very biased in the following way. If you get a bad output from the model, that's not the thing that you take on social media and to social media, right? You get the very best of the best. The average isn't like that. The average is actually much, much worse and much more difficult to sort of bound in terms of this reliability. Okay, so then, fine. All of this to say that we shouldn't build on top of these things. I think there's totally a way to build on top of these things. But we need to sort of thread this needle, right? It's a tough needle to thread, but not impossible. What I'm suggesting, and then we'll open it up to discussion here shortly, is that by understanding these limitations and by really understanding the domain where you want to deploy the model, where you want to deploy your product, you can generate a series of hypotheses. What are ways in which I could productize this technology? What are ways in which I could build checks and balances around it so that it provides something useful, right? So I can generate a series of hypotheses. What product can I feasibly build using this technology now that I understand what its capabilities and limitations are? And then let me go, after I reduce the search space, and do customer discovery on this much smaller search space, right? So none of this, we're going to use ChatGPT to diagnose all conditions, and much more like much narrower applications. Things like, you guys are going to laugh at this, but this is actually deployed, replacing the drive-through, the person that takes your order in a drive-through, with an AI. Now, that's actually a great use case for a feasible product. You go, it asks you what you want. You have a narrow set of responses that you can provide. Then you get your order, you get to see it to see if it's correct or not. If it's incorrect, you tell the model that, nope, that's not what I ordered. So it tries again. So it gets immediate feedback. And then finally, once you're sure that it's correct, you go and pay. Like, that's an example where you can use AI technology from the perspective of the business. You get to save in terms of human resources. And from the perspective of the consumer, you don't lose out on anything. You're able to buy cheaper burgers now, maybe. It's not a very sexy use case, but it's just one that sort of has some of these nice properties, right? So how do you generate these hypotheses about feasible products? Well, I think one of the sort of use cases where you can think about how you can build around these models in order to make them very useful is you'd want a structured environment. This is, use AI in a well-defined, predictable environment where the scope of the interactions is limited and clear, and reducing the likelihood for hallucinations. The more you narrow the scope of these models, the easier it is to bound their output. And by virtue of bounding their output, now you can build checks and balances around them using software engineering. The second is, does your application have the ability to provide immediate human feedback or human validation? So the example I gave about a person using AI through the drive-through, that has immediate human feedback. It's in a narrow, structured environment. Another example might be in call center applications. Often these companies have multiple levels, right? So the very initial person that you talk to is an entry-level person that has very little power. They can, make decision A, B, or C. And even if those decisions are made incorrectly, the consequences of making those decisions incorrectly is not that great. But a very large number of calls are then moved to, level 2 or level 3. So you could envision being able to replace sort of level 1 customer service individuals with these large language models that are very narrow in scope. And if you try to sort of work outside of their narrow scope, they'll say, let me, hand you off to a level 2 representative. And then 3 is integration with existing data and systems. So there's lots of applications where you may have specific data sets, things that can be used to further narrow the use case or to provide more reasonable answers. A really good example of this is we work with a clinical group in Phoenix that's focused on Alzheimer's disease. Now, Alzheimer's disease, unfortunately, doesn't have many solutions. Individuals just sort of progress through Alzheimer's disease at different rates, and it becomes very difficult for caregivers. So you have, let's say, your father, your mother, all of a sudden is unable to recognize you. And you're put in a position where, as a caregiver, you have no idea how to respond. Because you've never encountered that before. So they've amassed this massive evidence-based database of how do you provide responses that are helpful and evidence-based in a particular context. So now a caregiver can go and ask the model, hey, this is my background, this is my current situation, how should I respond? Should I try to convince them that yes, I am their son, or should I just like go with it? What's the right thing to do here? That's an example of a really useful deployment in sort of a healthcare application in that case, right? It's more for the purpose of the caregiver, making sure that they know how to react in these situations that are new to them. And now, after you generate these hypotheses, you go and you do customer discovery. Now, there's this great book called Talking to Humans. With ICK, we run another program, which a couple of the folks here, George and Dridan, were part of last year. That program is focused on customer discovery. The idea is that you have a business that you want to develop. Before you start building things out, you should go and talk to 100 customers to see if you're actually solving a problem that is of value. So this book, Talking to Humans, goes through a series of tips for doing that in a way that allows you to get maximum feedback. So I think once you generate these hypotheses, the idea is then you go and talk to humans to see if they're actually solving a problem that people care about. This can be a presentation on its own, so I'll just mention it here, but I'll sort of end with this because I think it's important. Yep, that's it. Question? Yeah. I think.
I need a mic. Okay. I have to make sure it's really low. But for the video, we need to put the video.
Thank you. Does this work?
Yes.
Shoot. Okay. So. I'm Dima, and we are building fintech AI solutions that has a lot of that are part of the core systems of financial institutions. So a lot of workarounds around these hallucinations and a lot of these issues. So kind of a question is if we cannot get out of the hallucination in the training,
yeah,
should we just try and scale more multi-agent systems that are using only context windows inside them? So because hallucination is a million times lower when it's in context window error. So on scalability size, there is now the other thing, it's the processing power, because when you have multi-agents, you use a little bit more processing than it. So what is, because I see that you have been going around those roads.
Yeah.
What do you think should be the right way forward when playing with this? It's experimenting at the end still.
Yeah, so I think there's one additional question I'll ask you, and then maybe I'll respond, is the output of these systems, is it automatically connected and triggers some other action, or is there a human that interprets it?
No, everything's automatic. So one of our products has over 80 different agents communicating with each other, checking, cross-checking responses, outputs, then combining 10 agents combine one output, give it to another, and all these combinations until you get the right response. With this way, we have reduced hallucinations to be less than 0.1%, which is pretty good to be deployed on, even on the International Space Station. It's a good error.
How many people are going to use the product?
We are right now with the first client is over 200,000. With the next ones that we are starting integration over the summer is going to be millions by the end of the year, hopefully, potentially.
So 200,000, that means if hallucinations are at 0.1%, you're going to have about 20 people that are impacted for every 200,000, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that becomes a question of whether that is acceptable for the domain that you're in, right?
Yeah, it is. If you put human errors are much higher than that.
Yeah, so then I think it's fine. Then I think it's totally fine. I think it's, and it seems like you've gone through the process of trying to minimize hallucinations, and you can't reduce them, but if you can reduce them to the point where they're acceptable in whatever domain you're deploying in, then I think it's fine. So what's the question about, like, it seems like, why would you want to change?
What is the right way forward when we are going? Now, should we, like, focus only on the quality of the output, but quality of output is not always scalable when you think in economic terms. So by your opinion, should we focus on the quality of output or try to find the middle ground between expenditure, resources needed to do all this?
I would do this sort of progressively. I would get to the point where the quality is at an acceptable threshold or maybe slightly below, and then I would think about reducing the operational costs.
And too late for that. We already went the other way.
So you reduced operational costs and then...
No, we first got like these benchmarks, everything, and then when we try to deploy the model, it was like really expensive to run it, no economy behind it. Like,
but you have a good model that's expensive to run. Is that the...
Yeah.
So there's lots of tricks you can play. I mean, one of them is distillation, right? So you can try and take this massive model and get a smaller model to learn on its soft outputs. I mean, that's getting into the technical details. But if you look at the new Llama 3 release, their small model is actually quite good. I don't know if it was trained using distillation, but if one of the things that's been observed is if you remove some of the weights, if you throw them away, the model output gets much, much worse. That wasn't the case with previous versions of Llama. So the idea is that this small model has learned a lot more about the domain that previous small models had learned. And so one way to do this, if you have already a good established model, is through a process called distillation, where you can distill the very large model into a much smaller one.
Another question on this side. When we are talking about all of these models, LLMs, we all know that everyone that was building our own, we scraped that and throw it away because the bigger guns outplayed us.
Sure.
So now it makes no sense for you to build your own. But
right.
When we are working with these enormous models, they are sometimes too enormous, too general. That's not always a good case. How do you find the middle ground of, like, should you go open source model and break it apart, but like then you have these less multilingual adaptability because open source are English, Chinese, and German only. These are kind of
We can talk in more detail afterwards. You're asking the right questions. I don't have all the answers. So actually, with a colleague of mine from the business school at ASU, I've encouraged them to think about the following problem, which is you have this technology that is changing very, very rapidly and along multiple dimensions. You have open models, you have closed models. At what point do you hit go on building product? Like, I mean, do you wait another 6 months or do you do it now? Like, what are the things to consider? I don't have a great answer for you without knowing more about the domain, but it's a good question, yeah.
But maybe to this whole thing, what I somewhat see again, right? So what definitely is true about this whole thing is that the cost of experimentation goes down a lot. I really liked what you said. This is also the reason why a lot of people now offer their first services as a freemium. But when we flip it a little bit around and say, okay, there's technology, what I somewhat miss is when we look at that, why don't we start exactly with the business problem, right? So only because there are no machines, the business problem is not changing. And I like basically, it was a little bit too complicated for me, the one slide where you came up with the three, but being German, we know exactly what robotics did, right? So we called it Industry 4.0. There was a very clear production process, and we say hey, now we're taking machines and help them to augment human tasks. It's the same thing.
There's one important difference. All of the robots in the Industrial Revolution was based on technology that would build bottom-up. We knew exactly how we built it. We knew exactly why we combined these parts in a specific way, and then we can debug them once they failed. I think what's different here is that the debugging becomes a lot more difficult. And this is sort of like the key difference between the changes that the Industrial Revolution brought and the changes that I think that, you know, the AI revolution is going to bring. I think they're going to be more difficult to realize because of this unpredictability and unreliability.
So you don't think that it's an optimization of human meets agents, bridging human and artificial intelligence and optimizing the threshold over time? So let's take a legal process, right? So you say, okay, I have a legal process, I can start from A to Z. And being a lawyer, I know exactly that A to D definitely won't work with what we see today. So I should maybe focus on the process from D to E and then jump and bring a human again in and then focus on. And not every so, and I always say, right there, as you said, there are models out there that are performant for certain use cases and they are expensive or less expensive. So from a business point of view, you just need to optimize them somewhat. And then
So I like this last thing that you said about the human being heavily involved and providing feedback about when a model is appropriate to use or not. Like, I think this is sort of what I was trying to capture with the second point here. I think the this is exactly how, at least in the near term, things will play out. I think the thing that's a little complicated is predicting how humans will react, like the what's called the socio-technical implications of introducing these technologies into society. Now, I'll give you an example with the OpenAI stuff last week or 2 weeks ago, whenever that announcement. Those voices sound really realistic, right? And if you think about having a human interacting with an agent like that, whether it's in law or for personal interaction, it becomes really difficult to predict what the introducing that into this system is going to do to the system as a whole. I think it was maybe a little more predictable in the past where we built the machines ourselves. But I think these will play out over time and you know, there'll be some mistakes made and there'll be value that's created along a number of different verticals. I think it's, and I just think it'll be slower than it's been predicted. Yeah.
Do you want the mic? Should I use the mic?
Okay, so nice presentation. It was
really
amazing. But what do you think about the implications that come with AI models being trained on intellectually protected data?
Ooh.
And the fact that OpenAI or Microsoft is being sued by New York Times. That happened in December and it's an ongoing case.
So I'm not a legal expert, so I have...
I'm a legal person tomorrow. She's right here.
Yeah.
So that's a discussion for tomorrow.
Or if she wants to answer right now, too. Like.
Hi. So spoilers for tomorrow. Thank you very much for the presentation. I think this is the one of the most important issues that come with AI that lean into the legal world. So IP, licensing, what can I do if I use a model and then that model is scraping information and data and IP protected matter. As a lawyer, I'm going to do what the lawyer usually does. It says, it's complicated, and there is no straight answer, but they are now looking, like every company that is now producing this kind of models and using AI and selling this kind of models to other companies, they're trying to find ways to protect and protect themselves. So if you are a startup that wants to use AI and you're afraid that this, like everything that you're taking out of this might be IP protected, I can give you like some, the basic concept of putting clauses in the contracts that you're signing that says that, okay, indemnity, whatever happens, it's not on me. It's on the provider of the model. Whatever I use, if that infringes any kind of IP right, it's not on me, it's on them. Now they, what they are doing is they're trying to find a way to either get material information from places that that material is not IP protected, IP right protected, or they're trying to find a way to make sure that they do that, but they don't have any fault on them. So this is basically the outline of what happens. But it's a very complicated matter, and it, like, you can, we can go out after that tomorrow if you want, or after this. But yeah, that's the outline more or less.
One of the nice things that's come out of all of this is just by virtue of people threatening to sue or maybe even suing, is that a bunch of these data licensing agreements have started. So I think OpenAI signed a deal with Reddit for the rights to use answers by Fucksmith and others in their models. But like, it, you know, this is now becoming more and more commonplace. And I think also with News Corp, with the Wall Street Journal and others. So, yeah. Did that answer your question? Yeah.
Thank you very much. So?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much for your presentation. My question is really specific. Let's assume that industrial companies that are manufacturing products are having a problem correlating their energy use with manufacturing process, let's say operations. And they're installing solar panels and also battery energy storage. And they are correlating these, let's say, price fluctuations on energy market with production, but they're not achieving this optimal point, let's say. And what we did is we're collecting data from some industrial, let's say, manufacturing companies, and we want to build a model. And we know what are the, let's say, main requirements to build such a, let's say, model to do a predictive maintenance. But my question is, should we, let's say, talk with electrical engineers that can, let's say, generate some limits when they can say if these are, let's say, spikes on energy consumption? Should we listen to them? Should we generate the model based on our own, let's say, data generated? Or should we, only specific in one industry, let's say beverage, or should we also build a model for different industries? So this is where should we focus? Should we build a model that is specific for one manufacturer, which can be beverage, let's say, or another? So maybe you got the point.
You're talking about load prediction, and then somehow changing access to power based on when you predict there's going to be a spike or not. Those spikes will be more and more predictable if you narrow the scope. So if maybe it's by domain, so like beverage manufacturers, or maybe it's by some other aspect of production. But clustering those companies to the point where you can develop a predictive model that's quite accurate, that's, I guess, would be maybe step one. And then step two, spikes are challenging. I think sudden changes to the model output will cause very sudden changes in the output. And getting domain expertise, so from power engineers or whoever, to make sure that those are done in a safe way and you're not throwing the system out of whack because you're trying to get it to do something that it wasn't meant to do and there's no safeguards for, is also a good idea. We can talk in more detail, but those are sort of the two things that come to mind.
Thank you very much for the presentation. My question would be along the lines, what would be, you probably know about Kosovo and the challenges that we can go ahead with the AI. What would be your, let's say, recommendation? How how can the businesses go forward more and focus more on this, and what can be, let's say, the partnerships of the future, you know, whether with universities, whether with more with businesses.
Yeah.
I mean, what's the idea? Because I'm thinking along those lines. I have a consultancy, but can we, you know, rally people and...
On specific problem areas where,
Or on a model that we can chase, or, you know, things like that. This is what I'm thinking.
Yeah. So I have a couple of ideas, but they're not necessarily super well thought out. So the first idea is a continuation of what people have been doing here recently, which is it's become very easy to be trained in these concepts independently. So you have lots of independent contractors now that sort of short-circuit the school system. They don't necessarily go to school, but they're self-trained online, and then they become AI engineers or they become software engineers. I think that will continue and maybe even amplify, right? It's become really, really easy to do that. But that's more at the individual level. I think what you're talking about is maybe the societal level. How do you do this? I think one of the worries, and we were talking about this over dinner last night, is that these models, this new technology is going to replace a bunch of human workers. I think maybe that's true in certain domains, but I also think it's going to create new jobs. So I think there's going to be lots of domains where someone will need to evaluate the output of these models to make sure that they're reasonable, right? So we have customer support now where humans can call other humans and talk to them. There's maybe some version of the future where you have a group of humans evaluating the outputs of these models to make sure that they're providing feedback that's reasonable. And by virtue of doing that, you're now generating a large data set that can be used to train the next generation model, right? That could be an interesting area, something to explore, because there's already a pretty good foundation here of customer support. For example, you can take that workforce and retrain them in something that's related but different. Those are a couple of ideas, but maybe this is a longer conversation. Yeah.
All right. I think we have to go over.
Okay.
We have another speaker joining us online.
Excellent.
But thank you very much, and I think you're going to be around.
Yeah, I'll be around.